talked about the total economic impact of climate change, but I haven't talked about its distribution. Now, we've seen this graph before, which shows the severity of climate change as a function of climate change itself. What I'm going to do is take this set of numbers, which shows the impact of a 2.5 degrees of global warming on the average person across the world, and instead I'm going to show the impact on people across the world. And that looks something as follows. On the vertical axis, we still have the Hixian equivalent variation, the Welfare equivalent income change. On the horizontal axis, we're now looking at per capita income in the year 2015. This is a logarithmic scale and it runs from very poor to very rich. The pattern is obvious. The negative impacts of climate change are concentrated in poor countries. The positive impacts of climate change are concentrated in rich countries. And there's a few exceptions, Singapore here, which is fairly rich, but fairly hot and therefore vulnerable. And there's cold countries here like Bhutan and Mongolia that are fairly poor but also fairly cold, so that would actually see some not so negative impacts of climate change. But by and large, the poorer you are, the greater the impacts of climate change. And there's three basic reasons for that. The first one is exposure. In poor countries, a lot of economic activity is in agriculture and therefore directly exposed to the vagaries of weather and climate. In rich countries, economic activity is in publishing and in ICT and in finance and in banking and in retail. It's much less exposed to climate change and weather shocks. So that is the first reason. The structure of the economy is different in rich countries and in poor countries, such that in poor countries, the exposure to climate change is much greater. That is the first reason. The second reason, this is the same data, but now we plot the impact of climate change against the current climate. See is another clear pattern, namely that the negative impacts of climate change are concentrated in hot countries and the positive impacts of climate change are concentrated in cold countries. And the reason for this is twofold. One, it has to do with the ability of natural systems to adapt. In hot countries, a lot of animals, a lot of plants are pushed towards the upper end of their thermal limits. Because hotter still, these plants will be plants and animals will be in trouble, including the plants and animals that we rely on. Whereas in colder countries, that is obviously not the case. Second reason has to do with adaptation. If you live in a city in a temperate climate and you wonder what climate change will do to you, if you live in London, then you could wonder what would life be like. If it warms by 2 degrees, well, then you have to look at Paris, or you can wonder what is life like when it's 4 degrees warmer, and then you have to look at Madrid. And it's clear what you need to do in terms of technological adaptation, in terms of behavioral adaptation, because people have sorted out how to live in such climates before. So that is a relatively easy adaptation. On the other hand, if you live in one of the hottest cities on the planet, Singapore, Dar es Salaam, Riyadh, then you cannot copy the technologies and behavior of other people because they simply do not exist. And that means that all your adaptation has to be invented from scratch. And that is simply much, much more difficult than copying other people's technologies and behavior. So that is the second reason why poorer countries tend to be more vulnerable than richer countries to climate change. And what I've got to say is that, of course, poorer countries tend to be in hot places, and hot places tend to be poor. So that is the second reason. And the third reason is a lack of adaptive capacity, which is much more pronounced in poorer countries than in hotter countries. So what is adaptive capacity? Adaptive capacity is just another way of saying it's the ability to adapt, and that depends on a range of things. First is that you need to have the technological wherewithal to adapt. So if we're talking about the impacts of sea level rise, then you need to know about the existence of seawalls and dikes, because otherwise you can't protect yourself against sea level rise. The second thing is that you need to be able to pay for those technologies. You need to have the economic resources to build those dikes. And that is another thing. And so technology tends to be less available in poorer countries than in richer countries. Richer countries are technologically more advanced. And of course, rich countries have more money than poor countries. So their poor countries lack an adaptive capacity in that sense as well. The third thing you need is that you need to be able to mobilize those economic resources to deploy those technologies. You need to be able to, and you need to be willing to. And that is the third thing, the third major component of adaptive capacity. Instead of talking about these things in abstract terms, I'm going to talk about a particular example, and I'm going to compare the Netherlands to Bangladesh. Both countries are low-lying deltas. Both countries are very densely populated. Both are vulnerable to floods from the sea as well as floods from the river, and in both countries occasionally a big storm sweeps through. Yet we think of Bangladesh as extremely vulnerable to sea level rise and climate change, and we think of the Netherlands as not so vulnerable. And the question is, why? Well, the first thing you may think is, well, the Netherlands is much richer than Bangladesh, and that explains the difference. That is true now, but the Netherlands started its modern dike building program in the year 1850, and if you compare the income of the Netherlands in 1850 to the income of Bangladesh in the year 2020, the gap is actually not that large. Economic resources probably cannot fully explain the difference. The second thing you may think of, well, the Netherlands is technologically much more advanced than Bangladesh. That is true now, but if you actually look at how these early dikes were built in the Netherlands, and these are pictures of the 1930s, not of the 1850s, you see that they were essentially built by hand. There's a little bit of machinery there, but it's by and large, these early dikes were built by manual labor. If you look at dike building in Bangladesh now, you still see a lot of labor, but you also see machinery that was simply not available to the Netherlands. The internal combustion engine was not invented until much later. and of course, Bangladesh now has access to satellite imagery, computer models of sediment flows along the coast and all that sort of stuff, things that the Netherlands simply did not have in the 1850s. So the economy cannot explain it and technology cannot explain it either. So what is the difference between the Netherlands and Bangladesh, really? Well, if you look at the political situation in Bangladesh, then what you note is that politics is all about getting rich and getting even with your political opponents. There is a very antagonistic culture amongst politicians, and Bangladesh is typically high up in the corruption ranks. And that simply means that instead of spending money on public goods, money is spent on, it disappears into Swiss bank accounts or in luxury flats in London. That is what public money is used for. Bangladesh is a democracy, and you would think, how do they get away with this? Well, there's two reasons for that. First, the poor do not carry much weight in decision making. Yes, they are allowed to vote, but they're typically fairly badly informed about politics, and they're easily bribed with a bag of rice or a t-shirt to vote for certain people. So they are simply bought off. And many think that floods are a punishment by Allah rather than a consequence of bad management by the government. So the causal connection between what is going on in their lives in terms of natural hazards and what the government does is not necessarily made. This is not unique to Muslims or to Bangladesh. if you read stories about what was going on in the 1850s in the Netherlands, and a lot of people also thought that floods were a punishment by God, rather than a lack of government or mismanagement by politicians. If you look at the flood maps of Bangladesh here, shown on your right, these are the areas that are most vulnerable to floods. And if you look at the map on the left, these are also the areas that are the poorest, and this is cause and consequence, right? So if the poor don't really count in decision making, then and floods mostly affect the poor, and floods are simply not a priority of the powers that be in Dhaka. And Dhaka is somewhat higher up the hills, and definitely the rich people in Dhaka live higher in the hills. And actually, a lot of rich Bangladeshi do not live in Bangladesh, but live in London and places like that. So this is simply not a political priority. Now, what is the difference with the Netherlands here? There was the European Spring in 1848, when people rose up against the elites. And that played out differently in the Netherlands than elsewhere in Europe. And what changed in the Netherlands is that there was the Thorbecke government. And the first thing they did was change the constitution. And the 1849 constitution did two things. One, it established a powerful central government. Before that, the Netherlands was pretty scattered in terms of its responsibility. The central government was simply not allowed and not able to do much about anything. Second, that government was broadly representative of the population, where, of course, we should realize that the population at that time was seen as Protestant men. Women and Catholics were not allowed to vote. And what did this new government do? Well, it went after public enemy number one. It is not that is floods. It is not that in 1850 Dutch people all of a sudden discovered that they were vulnerable to floods. No, they had been aware of that for centuries. But as soon as they had a government that was not completely corrupt, that was not just serving the interests of the oligarchs, as we would call them now, but that was actually serving the interests of the people. As soon as that government was in place, as soon as those conditions were met, a government that is capable and that is not corrupt, and a government that actually represents the will of the people, as soon as that happened, the Netherlands started building dikes and started reducing its vulnerability to floods. So going back to what is adaptive capacity? You need to know what you need to do. You need to have the technologies available to do something against your vulnerability. You need to have the resources to pay for those technologies. But you also need to have the ability and the political will to mobilize those resources to do something against your vulnerability.